You're listening to Bedroom Beethovens, where notable music makers break down stories accompanied by songs and melodies documenting growth through their 10,000-hour journey. And me? Well, my name is Cello, your host.
I am a bedroom Beethoven.
Hey everybody, welcome to episode 138 of the podcast. My guest this week is...
My name is Tim Gmeiner. My artist name is Ill Poetic, producer name Ill Poetic. Started out actually as an MC back in the early 2000s. Kind of moved deeper into production around the same time and produced a lot for myself and my team. As far as underground indie hip hop, which is kind of where I got my start, I would say the first notable production I did was for my guy Illogic from Columbus, Ohio. Back in the indie hip hop circuit is when I linked up with my guy Chris Oryk. At the time, he was known as Red Pill. And we produced a record together. Well, I produced it, but we created this record together.
But that's given. Twice upon a time, there was a man who died and lived happily ever after inside of this very chapter. Home of pawn shops, corner stores, porn shops, mic doors, folklore and corridors. A place where you either find beautiful in your life or just pray to find it when you die. Living in rhythm and decibels. They say life's a cycle, so this verse is pie to that last decimal. Let it go. Conceived today, we'll be born tomorrow with a new life that's meant to follow. And that's what's so rare. That's why we care. That's why it's beautiful, because it's there. I can feel it.
Ill Poetic releases his first installment of an ongoing production series, Portfolio 1, As Serious As Your Life. Inspired by Val Wilmer's book on the Black Free Jazz Movement, and this classic account of the new black music of the 1960s and 70s, celebrated photographer and jazz historian Val Wilmer tells a story of how a generation of revolutionary musicians established black music as the true vanguard of American culture, placing the achievements of African-American artists such as Ornette Coleman, John Coltrane, and Sun Ra in their broader political and social context. So As Serious As Your Life is an intimate and vulnerable work that funnels the urgency. Me and Ilpo, we run the gamut and chat about 15 years of boundary-pushing self-released albums, mashups, production work, graphic work, entrepreneurship, and even curriculum development. Ilpo has developed a wide spectrum of creative processes to express a range of thoughtful and honest work. It's in As Serious As Your Life where we see Ilpo use as versatile a palette as ever to articulate these deeper nuances in a record that reflects explorations of hip-hop, jazz, fusion, 70s, electronic music, and film scores. It's a buffet. It's a conversation you don't want to miss. But if you enjoy the podcast, consider supporting me over at patreon.com/bedroombeethovens. The link is in the show notes. Ad-free early episodes for only a couple of ducats. It's a win-win. And another week, another episode. Strap in and enjoy Bedroom Beethovens podcast, Ill Po, episode 138.
Move right now.
I can feel it. I can feel it.
Like we talked about before we started talking, I did want to thank Chris Oryk for the connect. I thought that was a good episode. And I thought you brought up a good point where if you work intimately with him, you know most of the stuff that we talked about, but only a handful of people know those stories. So I have to like dig every corner of the internet to get those stories to share it with people.
It was amazing hearing them. Like it honestly flashbacked me back to his living room when we were just kind of hanging out, shooting the shit during the wrap up of Instinctive Drowning. And I was hearing these stories about his family and his grandparents and the lineage of youth history. And I'd forgotten about it, but it was out of sight, out of mind. And so when you brought it back up in the interview, I'm like, it's like I was right back in his living room again. Like, yo, this is cool, man.
Yeah. So one thing that we didn't talk about concerning Indistinctive Drowning was I know the album meant a lot both to you, which is why I think Chris took a review of that album pretty hard when it got, I think, like a 6 or 6.5 out of 10. And because the more personal an album is, the more you put blood, sweat, and tears into. And to have a, you know, a guy listen once and give his take on it seems arbitrary. But we're human, and sometimes that shit gets to us. You're obviously proud of that record. But if you get low scores and post-release sees a massive drop in record sales compared to his other albums, which way do you go? Do you feel responsible? Do you say, fuck all that, it's a good album and we're proud of it? How do you process it?
I feel responsible as the producer as much as Chris. So now I'm sitting on the side of responsibility as if we did something wrong or we failed, right? And so on that side of the fence, I take the responsibility because I'm like, well, I'm the producer. And there were moments of me pushing Chris. I mean, Chris, not to take anything away, he had a vision for this record and he knocked it out the park. But those kind of pushes of, you know, oh, lean into this honesty, lean into this vulnerability. This is raw. This is beautiful. This is amazing art. You know, and we're in this moment when it, I guess it's not received as the prior record was received, you know, sales wise. I feel this responsibility. It doubled up because I had produced Illogic's kind of quote unquote comeback record. Similarly, it was a record that wasn't necessarily received well by his fan base at the time. And I felt this responsibility as a producer too, because it was a different record or a different sound from his prior work, and kind of knew it wasn't a record his fan base was going to instantly acclimate to, given that the different kind of sonic textures on it. But yeah, kind of feels like when I'm feeling in that responsibility or that I'm responsible mode, definitely kind of this dark cloud over the head of, oh man, I come around to get artists really into their bag of pushing their limits. And then I kind of like maybe fuck up their career a little bit. That's my job, apparently, is to come along and fuck great artists up. And that's not necessarily true. So when I'm on the other side, that's when I look at the record for what it is. And so specifically with Chris and Instinctive Drowning, when I think about that piece of work for exactly what it is, then I'm beyond proud of it. It's one of the highlights of my life, of my career, of anything I've ever been a part of. And I know in my heart, this is a fantastic record. And that's when I can look at the people who may not have purchased it or who initially may have pushed it to the side because it didn't sound like his last record. And this is when I don't mean this arrogantly, but I kind of look at them like, no, y'all just didn't get it. This is amazing. I'm cool with that. You know, so you're kind of playing with that dichotomy back and forth, but yeah.
Yeah. I mean, those records, like they always describe it as, you know, unflinchingly honest, emotionally visceral. And I think a lot of people just want to open up their New Music Friday playlist and just, you know, idly listen to something. And I don't know, like, it's like, you know, if I was a comedian, I wouldn't tell you anything about my life. I would just tell you observations. Like, you know, what's crazy about airports? Well, let me tell you, because if I was that vulnerable on stage and then people didn't respond well, it would make me like fall out of love. You know, you used to think sacrifice was a measure of dedication and success. So you and Chris put every ounce of yourself into this album. And then four years ago, you put total focus in your own release. Tell me what your life looks like when you're done. Like, you step out of the studio and you look around. Is your diet terrible? Is your wife unhappy? Are you behind on rent? Like, what are the pitfalls of extreme tunnel vision?
You knocked it out the park. That's a thing that I've definitely learned from over these past, I would say, 4 years specifically. But yeah, it was the same deal for me. I put a record out a year after Chris's record, and it's a record I've been working on for years and years as an artist and producer. And also, it's a record we used to like build our company up and build a budget up for. Like, we really went balls to the wall on that record. And I remember planning out the year of 2017. I remember kind of planning that year out ahead of time of like, all right, here's what I need to accomplish in the spring and in the summer and in the fall for this record, you know, video shoots, allocating budgets to the vinyl, when to get the record finished mixing and paid for so that we could get it mastered by this time. And it was this beautiful Google Doc of project management as art. You know, it was just all laid out there and it had it all working. And what I neglected to include in that little Google Doc was life and personal, you know, just personal shit. And how, if I was really going to dedicate a good chunk of that year toward releasing this record and finishing it, that I'd also be denying my, you know, some of my client work. I wouldn't be taking on as much production or graphic design work. I did lose balance with the family, you know, and sometimes that's necessary, but this was just, you know, to the extreme because of the buildup of the project. And so I remember that record came out, Idiot's Guide to Anarchy. It came out in November 2017. And I was so spent every which way on that record. Like I was broke because we had put all the money into it. I had not been building enough supplemental income to keep the bills paid. So I'm putting phone bills on credit cards and all that fun shit. And me and my wife are just on the opposite ends of the spectrum. And I'm sure she was in the right on anything that was happening at that point. I'll just say she was correct. And I was completely way out there because I was so focused on this record. And so, yeah, when it's all said and done, like I remember the day that record came out, it was a miserable day and it should have been an amazing day. I just remember thinking, yeah, not like this. I don't want to do it like this again. And, you know, so the cost of tunnel vision is, you know, the potential of losing other things that you realize you hold way dearer to you than you may have been aware of while you were kind of in that tunnel vision. Yeah.
Yeah. I'll take it one step bigger. I was listening to an interview with T-Pain and he said at the height of his career, he felt like he couldn't even live in the same house as his wife because his wife would have been a distraction. So he bought a house for her and she stayed on the other side of town.
I guess that's where, I mean, well, Kanye built built acres in Wyoming to focus on music, half a country away from his wife and family at the time in California. One could argue that that was not his greatest output of music, funny enough. Here you had he had the income, he had the money to build himself an entire sanctuary in the peace of the mountains and God's country or whatever, and have total focus on the music. Feels like the majority of people would agree that those last few records of his were not his strongest output. And maybe there's a really cool lesson in that, that it's okay to let people in and it's okay not to necessarily view your wife or your family or these other aspects of your life as distractions, but more so just shit that flows with the process. It's all part of the creative process and it's okay to let them in. It's okay to take your eye off this prize for a moment and enjoy the beauties of these relationships. And that prize will be waiting for you. And hopefully you feel a little bit richer and maybe you'll add some nuance and perspective to it because you took your eye off of it for a little bit. So yeah.
So when you released that album in 2017, at that point, you've been rhyming for about 20 years.
Yeah. Yeah. Pretty much. I mean, I started when I was like 8 years old. So probably even longer than that, but I don't count those third grade rhymes so much.
Walk me through it. Let's say you're eight and you listen to Don't Believe the Hype. How does that transform you?
Don't Believe the Hype actually was on the first mixtape that I was given in the third grade. That whole tape was transformative. Funny enough, I think part of what transformed it was that the kid who gave it to me, Jason Turner, I remember walking onto the bus after school with him and he kind of gave me a red pill, blue pill thing where he's like, hey, do you want to listen to a tape in my headphones, a cassette in his Walkman? And I'd actually never heard music in headphones before either. And he either offered me Megadeth or Public Enemy. And I just on a whim, I went with Public Enemy. I don't think there was any deep reason. I was eight at the time, but I just remember putting the headphones on and I'd never heard music inside of my head. You know, like it felt like the music was in my brain. It was bouncing around the inside of my cranium. And it could have been that if he would have put Megadeth in, I'd be like a huge metalhead right now making metal music. But hip hop is the first thing that I heard travel through my ears into my brain. And it just stimulated every possible neuron there was in there. So that's that. It was a wrap from there.
Even if you would have chosen Megadeth, right?
Yeah.
If you would have chosen the Megadeth, I mean, you still grew up in a black community with black schools and black friends, maybe going on to have black business partners, a black wife, black kids.
I think that would be interesting had I gone the Megadeth route. I'm now you have me traveling and wondering where where my music would have gone. And it could have been, that's, I'll have to sit on that one day when I'm riding the bus and postulate. It's funny, man. Like I haven't lived in Ohio for 7 years now. I've been out in San Diego. Prior to that, I was in Columbus for like 5 years, Cincinnati for about 8 years. And then I grew up in Dayton, Trotwood, Ohio. So in some form or fashion, Ohio has just like informed all of me, no matter which scene I was in. And I could really deep dive and cherry pick what each individual city and scene kind of gave me. I don't necessarily feel as ingrained in the scene anymore. whether that Cincinnati is probably the closest scene that I still feel ingrained with. That's the one I came up in the Cincinnati hip hop scene. But I mostly just kind of, I think it's online, you know, it's keeping in contact with like my favorite artists who have emerged out of that scene out of the past couple generations. And they kind of give me a lifeline in and a peek into how the scene is operating. And I get to try and toss my two cents in kind of humbly if I see a need. But it at least gives me a connection still. So I still feel a connection there for sure.
The blood in those veins now running like my toes. My body hopped the bus about the city that it loved and left a piece of its soul in the road. Yeah, it said.
I've been pretty well planted in San Diego, since the quarantine, definitely. But cyclically, I moved to Cincinnati to attend University of Cincinnati the year that the Timothy Thomas verdict kicked off. And I think what I've learned over time is it's not even to me that it's so much cycling back around. It just never stopped. You know, it's really been a continual event that happens like deja vu, but with a slightly different accessibility, whether it be video cameras, moving to camera phones, moving to social media, moving to whatever the next stage is. So there's the awareness factor has changed and it's grown that movement. But the through line of, say, George Floyd to Timothy Thomas to me is very, very direct. You know, it's they're very well connected. So yeah.
Do you remember how your mother reacted to those events? Like, rest in peace to her, but I know she was very vocal with equal rights.
Yeah. That's a good question. With Cincinnati in particular, I can't say I remember too well. I don't even know if I necessarily had a ton of those conversations. The interesting thing is, coming from Trotwood, Ohio, and this is what really blindsided me when moving to Cincinnati, is that I did grow up in a Black community, and it was kind of I call it a middle-class Black community. I don't know if by standards of American income, it would be considered lower middle-class, but I can just say it's a really beautiful town with generations of families, and it's very diverse. It's not like strictly a Black neighborhood, but it is predominantly. And it's a neighborhood that I came up in, you know, grade school through high school, where a lot of any race issues that popped up were typically from outside, of an outside nature. Like if folks went hitting a club up outside of Trotwood, you might feel some pushback from police or running into somebody. But Trotwood itself, it was just very kind of utopian in that regard. And it was kind of a mind blower for me to, you know, travel 50 miles south to Cincinnati, where we're on the precipice of this, you know, the Timothy Thomas situation and tons of buildup of other innocent, I want to say Black men. I'm not sure if there were a ton of women involved who were, you know, being beaten, killed, you know, at the hands of police. Not really aware that was happening next door. And so when I moved to Cincinnati, I felt the whiplash immediately of tension, of being on the bus and feeling like, wow, if one person says the wrong thing on here, this bus could be chaos. And crazy that, you know, 50 miles north in Trotwood, there's this kind of almost serene feel to things. And my mom was in Trotwood, so I don't know if she necessarily felt the resonance of that. I think she was more concerned with me being in school for the first time and, you know, being away from the house. I don't know if we ever really talked about that, but the difference was stark, though. I could say that for sure.
You know, we talked about, I guess, the summer of 17. What I wanted to talk about, interestingly enough, maybe that brought on the decisions for you to go back in college, but your wife as well also went back to college around that time as well.
Yes.
Was that directly related to her being on the sidelines and seeing that struggle and then like, hey, if you're going to better yourself, let me support you and we'll go through this fire together?
You put it way more poetic and heroic than I do. I usually just say, like, I was not even thinking about going to school. I had pretty much run out of options. But my wife at the time, she got laid off from her job and we had just moved into a new place. Our old place was the building was disintegrating and the landlord was horrible. We just kind of had to jump ship while we had a moment. And while we were jumping ship, my wife was laid off from her job. And so it was pretty much up to me to take care of, for a moment, to take care of a lot of bills with not quite the level of income I needed. And so I'm kind of struggling month to month just to get by. And she is too. We're both like hustling our asses off just to keep the bills paid and stay afloat. And she had the idea to go back to school. She wanted to shift her career path from teaching over to the health industry. And she was like, well, why don't you come back to school with me? And I had kind of sworn off school after my first iteration at 18 years old back in Cincinnati. And she was like, well, it's free. It's because it's California, and we are technically via California, we are definitely below the poverty line. And so I was like, well, what the hell? Might as well try and get a degree for what I do. And I didn't really think to treat it as something so serious. But it wasn't until we really started getting back into school that I just kind of threw myself all the way into it. And she did too. And it became a great point of teamwork for both of us to keep pushing each other. And it was kind of a model for our kid as well to like watch it, transpire. Like, here's what going to college looks like. Here's what the sacrifice it takes.
And you're getting your BA in interdisciplinary computer and music.
Yeah, it's a lot of syllables.
We'll call it ICAM.
So, yep, that works. ICAM. It's a program at UCSD, University of California, San Diego. And I had my first year last year. It was all virtual because of COVID. Thankfully, because travel is, I live on the opposite side of San Diego. But yeah, next week I start back this next school year, and I'm trying to get my mind back into it right now because it is an intense program.
But I looked into it. Let me know if I'm hitting close to the mark here, because regarding your degree, it's open ended to the point where you can tailor it to your whims rather easily, but it's also extremely easy to get overwhelmed and lost within the fray if you don't have a particular objective in mind. It's great if you want to go into art installations or sound art or audio engineering or interactive media. So it sounds like at its core, ICAM is kind of like putting new media art, experimental music, and computer science into a blender.
Very much. Yeah, you hit the nail on the head. You should probably... I might have to pass them this little snippet of the interview and tell them.
I'm going to write the brochures.
Exactly. It is very much like that. I will say a highlight of returning to school later in life after kind of, pushing through the first portion of my career or whatever, as an independent artist or business owner is you, and maybe this is just part of getting older, period, but you can kind of look through, as you said, the fray and see what you want out of the thing. And it's a little bit easier. I always relate it to the Matrix and, seeing the numbers trickle down the wall and kind of realize that sometimes you can walk through walls because they're not really walls. And when you're starting out college and you're 18, 19 years old, there's this kind of understanding that you go through this, if you graduate high school, then you go to college and then you get a degree in a thing and then you get married and then you get a house and a family and then you get a job and then you retire and then you die. And that doesn't necessarily always work out. So going this kind of independent artist autonomous route, by the time I circled back around to college, I can look and see, here's pretty much what I'm looking to get out of this thing. And I'm willing to walk through some walls to make that happen if I need to. So I agree with what you're saying. If you come in with enough of a vision in mind, but you still allow the program to sculpt your vision and to lead you to some new, curious, creative directions, then it's very beneficial. But I definitely recommend coming in with some incentive or a passion towards something, or else, you do kind of get every class is a shiny new object and a challenging one that can whoop your ass if you don't have a reason that you want to be there for. So yeah, it's very accurate, man.
Your mom put a great importance on higher education. She wanted you did she want to follow the whole right after high school, go to college, get married, white picket fence? Is that the formula that she envisioned?
No, she didn't want the formula at all. I think she saw the route that I was leaning toward from college my first time around. And she really wanted me to stick with, funny enough, she was kind of a strong seer in this direction. She she really pushed me toward my art and graphic design, because I used to do art crazy in high school. And I just assumed I would do art because that's what was kind of told to me by like my counselors and my teachers. Like, you're good at this, you should do this. And so she was like, you know, you should, have you ever thought about staying in school for art kind of thing? And I'm like, no, I'm really burnt out on art. I really don't like doing art that much. Well, I think if you went back to school, you'd be a great teacher, a great educator. I'm like, no, mom, like that's not really what I'm trying to do, you know? And so it's not that we were at odds per se. We didn't like fight about it, but it was kind of in my 20s, I would say 20s to late 20s, it was a point of like, oh man, I don't want to talk about this with you right now kind of thing. I'm sure all adult kids have that conversation with the parent many, many times. But yeah, it's honestly not until I've gotten older and now I find myself back in school, you know, creeping up on 40, getting a degree that allows me to kind of merge the audio and visual fields in a much more exciting way for me, as well as kind of doing this curriculum development stuff. And I'm like, oh, you had it right, mom, but you were like 20 years ahead of, you know, ahead of the game, ahead of the curve. So I'm just slow. I'm catching up to her right now. So yeah, I'm not mad at all.
Yeah. I mean, what's funny is when you graduate from this particular program, at the end of the tunnel is the senior project thesis. So you get 2 quarters to create a portfolio piece to serve as a representation of what your past 4 years mean to you and your career mm-hmm. ambitions. If you would have did that at like 18 to 22, it probably wouldn't have been as profound as how it's going to be. Because on the music side, aspiring producers, usually how they handle their senior project thesis is they record an album. So right. your actual senior project thesis could be your next album, because you have to put like a fully fleshed out project.
And it could be. I know I could do that. And I figure, you know, I'm here, I'm in this program. I have a scholarship into this program, which is amazing. It's the hugest blessing, where to me, I'm getting paid to essentially explore my creativity and be challenged and push boundaries. And like I said, when I first went back to school, I thought, let me just get a piece of paper that says I can do this and be done with it. And school totally, you know, stripped all the arrogance out of that initial idea or sentiment. And so by now, you know, taking these classes on like computer programming, which discrete mathematics, like things that I got into music to avoid taking classes like this. And then I find myself here anyway. I'm like, well, I'm here, man, and I have to learn this stuff. And rather than have to learn it, maybe I just need to reframe it that I get to learn it. And if I get to learn it, then what new tools and skill sets do I have, knowing how to, you know, dive into code or graphic programming, and how can I use my pre-existing skill sets like in graphic design and music production to start getting into fields like you mentioned before, like installations, like 3D mapping, projection mapping, and audio visual real-time performance, virtual reality, things where I'm now surrounded by kids half my age who are just doing amazing things in these fields. And I'm like, why constrict myself to just putting out a record? Like, I know how to do that already. I didn't need school to teach me that. So yeah, I might as well learn something while I'm here.
So you're saying that, you know, now that when you get the degree, like you can take bigger risks in your music. You can teach for a year. You can write a column for a publication. You can mentor a kid. And then you can come back to music when you feel like doing it instead of doing it out of necessity.
And even taking music to fields, kind of where I'm at with it now, is taking music into areas that I just had never thought of, like virtual reality, like learning ambisonics and spatial audio. And that's something I wasn't really too focused on until this past year, but in understanding it, now I'm like, well, this is really awesome. Or you know, like I said, live audio visual performance and learning these programs and how they integrate. And I'm like, well, shoot, like maybe a record isn't the centerpiece anymore. Maybe releasing an album isn't necessarily the end all be all. Maybe a virtual reality presentation is the next release. You know, maybe that's what it looks like. Maybe it is a performance in the desert with 3D holographic visuals, and the music is the soundtrack to that performance. And it doesn't have to so much be, listen to this album, listen to what I'm doing on this album, go stream it on Spotify, or, you know, download it on Bandcamp. Like, y'all can do all that. That's cool. I don't want to stop you from doing that, but how can I reinterpret and repurpose this music in some places in ways I just never would have thought of before?
Yeah. I don't know. I'm glad you're not in the rat race. You know, like you do an album with Chris Oreck, and you're waiting for Mellow Music to give you another opportunity. Or same with the Logic, right? He does two whole albums with Blueprint, then decides to do a whole album with you. And I can't help but think about the position of Blueprint. Is, you know, is he sour that he doesn't get to do another album? Was there a conversation where, like, hey man, I'm gonna let another producer take the reins and see how that opens up my artistry? You know, I can't help but think there's a level of ownership between producer MC albums, and it can get personal when you don't get a call back to do another one. So I don't know. I just think that this is a smarter route, you know, less red tape and less bullshit to deal with.
I really value those relationships. And though as a producer, I'm really big on the psychology of production, you know, like making the beat is cool. Building the instrumentation around it is cool. The arrangements, the drum program, like all that stuff is cool. But underneath it all is the relationships. And if you have someone like Chris or like Illogic, where you like, who wouldn't want to produce to the ends of the earth for them? You know what I'm saying? Like, why wouldn't you want to say, you know what? Let me call some musicians in for this record. In fact, let's all pre-COVID, let's all get in the studio together. Like, let's record this with these people in it. Let's get everyone's vibe in here because I love these musicians and we've built a rapport. And then you're just producing the psychology because of these relationships, because these are amazing human beings and you just want to go to the ends of the earth for them. And I have no interest in taking on a project that doesn't, whether it be another rapper, a vocalist, a visual collaborator, whatever it is, I have no interest in taking on a project with someone that I don't want to spend a lot of time with learning and working with. It's just life is too short. I don't want to surround myself with miserable people.
And I want to talk about the, Idiot's Guide to Anarchy, which is, you know, if you're a musician and you didn't pay attention to that workshop then, I bet you're doing it now because, you know, I guess, from the sidelines, I haven't been seeing musicians really pivot smartly to this new landscape. And you have this new record out, and I know that you've been using your own teachings and putting them in place during this pandemic. And your survival instincts kind of kicked in and you're getting a degree. But I feel like this new album is just a puzzle piece that kind of fits in that. So I want to give you the floor to kind of tell people about the project.
So this new project that just released is called Portfolio One, As Serious As Your Life. And I actually never meant it to be an album. It was never supposed to be a follow-up to my last record, which makes it all the more humbling and rewarding in its reception. So initially this was built to be just the portfolio of my production work and just kind of how I get down as a producer. So whether it be beats, whether it be bringing in, live musicians, the mixing, the mastering, collaborating with other producers, vocalists, MCs, kind of sprawling across the genres that I love to work in, from kind of hip hop, ambient, electronic, jazz, rock, fusion, just kind of all over the place. I just started amassing this collection of music over the past 3 years. And, I put it out about 2.5 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago. Didn't really have any plans to press it up on vinyl or anything. It was just supposed to be something to get out to other musicians, vocalists, visual collaborators, people that I just wanted to work with. Like, here's what I do. I'm tired of sending beat tapes out to people. You can just go stream this on Spotify or Bandcamp and you can get a feel for how I get down. And the reception was just amazing. The reviews, the feedback I got from my core supporters, I don't have a ton of fans, which I'm cool with, but the ones I do have are fantastic. And they let me know this is like some of your best work, if not your best work. And for me, not even realizing this was an album that I was putting out until it came out, that was very humbling. And I've just been, any feedback I continue to get on it, the streams have been steady. It's all surplus. This is all just icing on the cake, you know. Like it was fantastic before it even came out. So all the love it's getting now is strictly icing on the cake, and I'm loving every fucking second of it.
I bet you were just like, damn, man, like this is some of my best work. And I didn't kill myself to make this record and I'm getting this response.
Yeah. And man, that was a big one for this campaign, learning from the sins of the past, man. Like I scheduled this release, I think August 17th, so come up a month now. August 17th was the release date. And the reason it could not go past August 17th, I told my team, we had like weekly meetings with my team. I'm like, we cannot release past August 17th. And they're like, why August 17th? I'm like, well, August 24th is my anniversary. And I refuse with my wife and we have plans and I'm not going to let this release spill over into our anniversary. I'm going to be intent, you know, purposeful and focus on this release up until it drops and give it a couple days after. And I'm sure I can return to it, but then I'll be purposeful and with intent when I'm with her for our anniversary. And then I had this road trip with my dad these past couple of weeks across the country. And I'm like, I don't want to be worrying about sending emails to, you know, make sure the record is properly streaming on platforms when I'm like halfway through Arizona. And I'm supposed to be spending this time with my dad. It's a really special moment. So this was my first attempt to not let the music and the project take over my life, more so let it integrate into my life. And I was prepared to not to face the repercussions of that. Like, well, maybe this record won't be received as well and people won't really check for it. And I got to be okay with that because I'm not willing to sacrifice anything else in this balance. And I was rewarded for it. People really messed with it. And it taught me a really valuable lesson that I don't have to tunnel vision so deeply into a project that, you know, that I risk it all in other avenues. So yeah, it's been an amazing lesson with this record. It's made it one
so awesome, man. I'm so glad to hear that. And also I'm coincidentally I'm binge watching Breaking Bad, so I'm very familiar with Tuco's warehouse that you you stopped yes. by. I just saw that episode.
It's so great. I asked my dad if we could park in the car. I'm like, because we stopped in Albuquerque and we stopped at a food, it's like a vegetable spot. And I'm Googling, I had a whole map of different Breaking Bad places and I'm trying to figure out like, man, which one can I hit that's still not too far off and take us too far off our path. And Tuco's, it was, I think, what is it called? Java Joe's, maybe it's a coffee shop now, is the name of the spot. And I'm like, yo, this is like 4 minutes away from where we're eating food. So it's like, man, do you mind if I go over there? And awesome. So when I see the scene, I went and watched that episode of Breaking Bad in the motel after my dad fell asleep. And like, now I gotta watch the episode again so I can put myself in there. And I'm like, yo, like Walt Heisenberg is walking out of the building after it's all blown up. And I'm like, yo, we were parked right there, like right next door here. So yeah, I don't get geeked about a lot of that type of stuff, but I will fan out over Breaking.
I'm running through five seasons in a week. I'm housed up in a hotel because of the hurricane and I'm just blowing through the series. So very cool, man. And I'm glad that you're relaxed, recharged. You got to spend some quality time with your family. And I'm happy that I can use my platform to get you new fans, get people to listen to this project. And I'm really honored that you reached out to come on and we were able to connect. For
sure. Yeah, man. I'm happy to hear that you're safe in the midst of the hurricane, man. So, but worse ways to spend a time waiting for a hurricane to pass, I guess, than watching Breaking Bad. But happy you're there and doing all right, man.